Greeting once again from Revelation 14:1 Ministry here in Santa Rosa, California. As we've stressed every Sabbath, that this ministry is dedicated to sharing the truth while we are very much aware of the false teachings that has flooded Christianity of today. We have been studying about Islam and how it was formed last week according to the ex-Jesuit priest Alberto Rivera. So those were words of men. Today we will dig into God's word to see whether God has already foretold about Islam in his words. So the topic today, as we will see, is Islam as foretold by the Holy Bible. Islam as foretold by the Holy Bible. So that is what we are going to study today, and hopefully we will be able to mesh it together with what Alberto Rivera told us last week and other and history that is well recorded. Okay, let's have a quick review. Last week we found out that the Babylon religion of Rome had a facelift to create a counterfeit religion called the Roman Catholicism. This Babylonian religion was given a facelift so that it becomes a fake Christian religion. And that religion is the Roman Catholicism. Why do we say that? We'll find out. We found out last week what they actually did. Jupiter was turned into Saint Peter. Venus was the goddess Venus was changed to Mary, the Virgin Mary, and many other things too that happened along the way by rebaptizing the pagan gods into Christian figures that were recorded in the Bible. Number two, Roman Catholic priests were directly involved in the early training of Muhammad. We found that out according to Muhammad, that Muhammad's aunt and her brother were closely, who were both Catholics, Catholic converts, they were both closely involved together with Catholic priests in Arabia at that time in training this man Muhammad. Muhammadism or Islam came to being, it should be came to being in the early 1600 and 1700 AD. We found that out from history. Number four, the Dark Ages began in 538 AD, also in history. What is the Dark Ages? When Rome ruled the whole civilized world in Europe at that time. 538 AD was that year that Rome began to rule. And finally, number five, the Reformation began by Martin Luther in Wittenberg in Germany. Martin Luther was a Roman Catholic priest who found the Bible, the original Bible, studied it, and he realized the false teaching that the Catholic had been preaching all this time. That happened in 1517 AD. Okay, let's move on from there. What does the Bible say about Islam? So we've heard from Alberto Rivera. we've heard from history. Now, let's dig into the Bible itself. This book that we uplift all the time. Let's see if God the Holy Spirit had inspired his writers to inform us about Islam. We know that Islam is often described as the religion of the firstborn of Abraham, Ishmael. The Bible talks a lot about Ishmael and his descendants. So we see, mentioning Ishmael, the Bible mentions him because he was the firstborn of Abraham. Daniel 11 mentions the king of the south agitating against the king of the north. Who are these two kings? We'll find that out too. And number three, the book of Revelation specifically talks about the religion and its effect to the people of God. So all of these are happening around the people of God. Or Christianity. True Christianity, we're referring to true Christianity. We learned last week that fake Christianity or a counterfeit religion was created to counter true Christianity that was started by Jesus in Jerusalem. So we're not talking about that fake Christianity. The surrounding of the true people of God by the two kings, the king of the north and the king of the south, is what we will explore this week. This week we will only touch on some Old Testament texts referring to the early movements of a nation of people away from God and eventually into Islam. We know that Ishmael was the son of Abraham, and Abraham was that man of God that God chose to move him out of Ur and made him wander right down to Egypt and back into the promised land. So Ishmael was his firstborn. How come Ishmael led his people away from God? We'll find it out. Together with the Old Testament prophecies, we will try to connect the truth about what Alberto Rivera, the ex-Jesuit priest, said about the formation of the religion. So we'll try and connect the dots. We'll try and put together this jigsaw puzzle in order to come up with the truth. Let's start from Genesis, right in the beginning. Genesis chapter 16, verses 11 and 12. It reads, "And the angel of the Lord said unto her," to Hagar, Ishmael's mother, "Behold, thou art with child, and shall bear a son, and shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord hath
heard thy affliction."
So Hagar was pregnant with Abraham's son. Remember, Hagar was the maid that serves Sarai, the wife, Abraham's wife. When Sarai could not bear a child for Abraham, she was desperate. They were getting old. So she brought her maid, Hagar, the Egyptian, and told Abraham to sleep with her, with Hagar. And this is the result, Ishmael. So now, this verse is telling us that Hagar is crying out to the Lord. And the Lord is saying that, "I've heard your cry, Hagar. You will bear a son and you shall name him Ishmael." But listen to what God had foreseen this man to be. "And he will be a wild man. His hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of his
brethren,
right among his brethren." See, that's where he will be. And Abraham was 86 years old when Hagar bare Ishmael to Abraham. How old was Abraham? 86. That is
86.
4 scores is 80, and 6 is 86. So Abraham was already 86 years old when he bore Ishmael. So they were very old. Remember, Sarai was desperate that they were getting old, 86. And that's why she wanted someone to inherit Abraham's wealth. That was in verse 16 of Genesis chapter 16. When Abraham was 99, in verse 18, I'm not sure whether it's the same chapter or the... Let's read verse 18. It says, when Abraham said unto God,
Oh, that Ishmael might live before thee.
And God said,
Sarah, thy wife, shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him.
So God was telling Abraham everything about his promise of a son and his promise to his descendants. But Abraham said, yeah, I know God, but there's my son here. He was now 99, another 13 years after Ishmael was born. So he wasn't really looking forward to having a child anymore because he was old. And he's saying, yes, Ishmael is there, God. He said, no, I'm not talking about Ishmael. You will have another son by Sarah. And Sarah will bear you a son and you shall name him Isaac. And he said, my covenant is between me and Isaac, not with Ishmael. Yet another promise to Ishmael. This is another promise by God. In Genesis 17, verse 20, it reads 22:3.
And as for Ishmael, I have heard thee. Behold, I have blessed him, and I will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. 12 princes shall be beget, and I will make him a great nation.
So Ishmael, the promise of being a great nation in this world, has been promised to Ishmael. And he says, he will have 12 princes who will make him that great nation. 12. Remember, Jacob too had 12 sons, the 12 tribes. Ishmael had 12 princes as well. The 12 princes, Genesis chapter 25, 12 to 18. We'll just read 12 to 14. Now these are the generations of Ishmael, Abraham's son, whom Hagar the Egyptian, Sarah's handmaid, bare unto Abraham. And these are the names of the sons of Ishmael by their names, according to their generations, the firstborn of Ishmael, Nebajoth. That was his firstborn. And there's Kedar, and there's Abdil, and there's Mibsam, there's Mishma, and Duma, and Massa. Verse 14. Verse 15 says, there's Hadar, and Tema, and Jetur, and Naphish, and Kedema. 12 of them. These are the sons of Ishmael, and these are their names. By their towns and by their castles, 12 princes according to their nations. God's promise to Ishmael for what he had to face under Sarah's household, the 12 princes, and they are all here. And these are the years of the life of Ishmael, and 137 years, that's how long he lived, and he gave up his ghost and died and was gathered unto his people. So that was the story of Ishmael. But when he died at the age of, 137, he left these 12 princes with all their descendants. In Genesis 25, verse 12 to 18, one of the verses there reads, 12 sons and princes do indeed come out of Ishmael and live in a land we now refer to as
Arabia.
Arabia. His descendants would one day create the Arabian Empire, one of the greatest the world has ever known. That is the descendant of Ishmael, the son of the firstborn of Abraham. Let's see what Isaiah, much later on in history, said about the descendants of Ishmael. Isaiah chapter 21, verses 13 to 17, it reads, "The burden upon Arabia, in the forest in Arabia shall ye lodge," you come and live out there, "O ye traveling companies of deadening, the inhabitants of the land of Tamar
brought water to him that was thirsty. They prevented with their bread him that fled. For they fled from the swords, from the drawn sword, and from the bent bow, and from the grievousness of war. For thus hath the Lord said unto me, Within a year, according to the years of an hireling, and all the glory of Kedar shall fail, and the residue of the number of Uches, the mighty men of the
children of Kedar,
shall be diminished,
for the Lord God of Israel hath spoken it." So these are the descendants of Ishmael. Two are mentioned here, Tamar and Kedar. And where are they inhabited? In the deserts of
Arabia.
Arabia. That's where they are found. Remember what Alberto Rivera mentioned in last week's study? He said that the Roman Catholic Church looked from Rome and saw the descendants of Ishmael there in Arabia. There were many of them, so they were going to use them for their purpose. What was their purpose? To get hold of Jerusalem and make it one of their holy cities. But let's see. This is a map that shows where they were. Can you see Kedar there and Tamar? And the other names around the Arabia, Dedanite, that was the son of Cush, the grandson of Noah. So you see, all these people came and mix up in this area here. We have Kedar here and Tamar. They are both the descendants of Ishmael. They intermarried with other families out there. And they become a very strong nation. No wonder Arabia became a very strong nation sometime in the past. So this was the Arabia in Isaiah's time. So you see, the descendants of Ishmael are there occupying the land. These are some of the key cities and area in Arabia. You find Tamar there, in Saudi Arabia, and you also find Kedar, the Kedar tribe. Those are both Ishmael's descendants. So they intermarried with the other Arabian families who occupy the land, and they became a great force. Remember, at this time, there's no Christianity. Christ was not born yet. There was no Roman Catholicism, this time we're talking about. There was no Islam, no Muslims. All we have here are a group of pagan believers, Ishmael's descendant. And we have the people who were worshipping God. They were all over the place as well. Well, let's move on to Daniel 11. Daniel 11 specifically talks about the Islamic nation. One, it given that the prophecy is written from a Jewish perspective, Daniel 11. Remember who wrote it?
Daniel.
He was a Jew, so he's writing it from a Jewish perspective. Directions such as south or north are given in relation to Jerusalem, the ancient capital of the kingdom of Judah, Jerusalem. Number two, the king of the south would be referring to the power of the nations south of Israel. Well, that makes sense. So when he's now in Babylon, where Daniel is writing all this, when he's thinking about home, north of home are the kings of the north, and south of Jerusalem were located the kings of the south. So he's writing in terms of that. King of the north would likewise refer to the powers north of Israel. God's people in between. Let's look at the map of that area. You see, Jerusalem is right there. This is the Mediterranean Sea. South of God's people is the king of the south, Egypt. North of Israel is Syria. And if we remember correctly, in Daniel chapter 2, we studied about that image. Do you remember the image? With the head of?
Gold.
Gold. A chest of?
Iron.
Silver. And a thigh of?
Brass.
Brass. And the legs of?
Iron.
And the foot of?
Iron and clay.
Mixture of iron and clay. Remember, when Daniel was
Babylon,
writing this, it was only the head.
Mm-hmm.
The head. He was in Babylon. Remember, they were taken prisoner mm-hmm. to Babylon. That's where he saw this vision and he wrote it down. So he's foretelling the future. God is foretelling the future to him. The head is the head of gold, and it represents Babylon. The shoulders are made of silver, and it represents the next kingdom who will come and invade Babylon. And that is Medo-Persia. Third kingdom, which is?
Brass.
Kingdom of Greece, made of brass. And fourth is Rome. That was when Rome ruled the world. It was Jesus' time. So we'll see how this come into play in the our study about Islam. So you see that during the third kingdom, which one is the third kingdom?
Greece.
The kingdom of Greece. We saw a goat
mm-hmm.
with how many horns?
One
horn. And it said that Daniel saw that with that one horn fell off mm-hmm. and in its place came?
Ten.
No?
Four
horns. Who was the leader of the Greek Empire? Alexander
the Great.
He was only 31 when he ruled the whole world. Mm-hmm. Only 31. He ruled the whole world. He was that one horn of the goat. And the vision said that that horn fell off and four came in his place.
Mm-hmm.
What does that represent? Alexander the Great in history records that he had four generals. And the four generals' names are recorded right there. Number one, Macedon. Number two, Pergama. Number three, Seleucus. And number four, Ptolemy. When Alexander the Great died, his kingdom was divided amongst these four. And look at where these kingdoms are. Macedon took over this part of the kingdom. Pergama took this part of the kingdom. Seleucus, he took up all this yellow part.
Huh.
That was Seleucus. And the fourth,
Ptolemy.
Which was Ptolemy, he took up this southern part, which was Egypt, Arabia, and all those areas. So that was how it was divided up. But you see, these two smaller kingdoms were eventually taken over by the north. The kingdom of the north, which was Syria.
Seleucus.
Yeah, he took up all these. So we are now left with the northern kingdom, led by Seleucus, and the southern kingdom, led by
Ptolemy.
So king of the south, south and king of the north begin to appear here. Doesn't it? No, it becomes much clearer with the map. The king of the south and the king of the north.
Mm-hmm.
These are two, both pagan nations. But they surrounded, the importance of studying them is because they surround who? The people of God who are located right in between.
Mm-hmm.
When whatever these two nations do, who is affected? The people of God who are right there in between. King of the south, king of the north. Right in between here are the people of God. So you see, physically they are affected. And that's also what will happen spiritually. We have the king of the north and the king of the south. What are these two powers doing will affect the people of God, you and me. Okay, I hope that clarifies some historical fulfillment. Daniel 11, 2 and 4 predicted historical events that came to pass in the Persian and Greek Empire. We've already talked about that. Specifically, verse 4 describes the division of the Greek Empire. Seleucus and all those... one of the four divisions of Alexander's empire was located in Egypt, which was south of Jerusalem. The leader of this kingdom is the king of the south, spoken of in verse 5. In history, the rulers of this kingdom based in Egypt were called the Ptolemies. The Ptolemies. The division of Alexander's empire that was to the north of Jerusalem was Syria, whose kings were called the Seleucids. The Seleucid leader was called the king of the north in verse 6. So you see, I've already explained that from this map here. The Seleucid, king of the north, and Ptolemies, king of the south. These two were taken over by this strong kingdom, Seleucus, and they all became the king of the north. See where they are located, north of Jerusalem, and they come right up into Europe. Who's the king of Europe today? We'll come to that later. So, lost one. So there's a jigsaw puzzle that we have to solve. Okay, that's 1, 2, and 3, then 11. Eh? The fourth thing that we learned, the fifth thing, is of this jigsaw puzzle. Christ's time rose. Somehow we've lost one slide. No. See, there should be 4 points before this. Anyway, I'll see if I can remember. Christ's time rose on the new religion of Christianity. Okay, let's just go back. I think I'll look at Rome. In that image on the far, far right, top head of gold is
Babylon.
Then Middle Persia, then Greece, then Rome. Okay? So Daniel was speaking when he was talking about the king of the south and the king of the north, he was talking about the time after the Greek Empire, after Alexander. He was seeing the future. God was showing him the future. When the four generals took over, the four horns of that goat. So Daniel, when he's writing this prophecy, he's talking about this part of the image. After this image, because the four divisions of the Greek Empire. So you see, right after the Greek Empire came the Roman Empire. So the religion of Babylon passed down through Medo Persia, through Greek, even though they invaded, they accepted the religion. And right into the Roman era, the leg of iron. So Rome was practicing the Babylonian religion. And we heard that too from Alberto Rivera last week. The religion of Rome was the Babylonian religion. And we heard that they baptized these images to become figures in the Bible. So that was the religion then. And if we go to point number five here. However, after Christ's time, Christ came during the Roman Empire, during this part of the, remember that is 168 BC to 426 AD. So somewhere in between there is the change from BC to AD. And that's when Christ was on earth. So we will see now that Daniel was forecasting all this through this. So after Christ, what's the new religion that is spreading throughout the lands now? Christianity. There was the Roman Babylonian religion. There was the Jewish religion. And now there's Christianity and there's the pagan, Ishmael's descendants. They were all pagans. So these are the religions that were all spreading throughout this area at that time. Christianity sprang out right after Christ. Point number six is we found out from Alberto Rivera last week that around 200 AD, the Roman Church was threatened by the spread of Christianity to the Gentiles and formed a fake or counterfeit Christian religion, which is the Roman Catholic Church, and named it Roman Catholic, which also believed in the Bible, but had greatly compromised its teaching with their Babylonian beliefs. One of their doctrines was the divinity of the sun. There was the sun god. No wonder we are worshipping on the day of the sun today. Point number seven, from 200 AD to 538 AD, Christianity was slowly compromised from its totally pure belief to a very diluted one. In 321 AD, Constantine introduced the first day of the week as another worship day. And this brought in the sun worshippers into Christianity. They've diluted the true doctrines of Jesus. And in the process, invited the sun worshippers into Christianity. Okay? Point number eight is that the Bishop of Rome was empowered and began the persecution of true Christianity during the 1260 years papal rule called the Dark Ages. When did this happen? 538 AD. 321, Constantine, Emperor Constantine became a Christian and invited sun worshippers into Christianity. 538 AD was when the Pope of Rome was given both the religious and the state power. He owned the military, and that's when he began the persecution of Christianity. Point number 9. According to Rivera and Cardinal Bear, around 200 AD, the Roman Catholic Church was planning to form another religion. We heard that last week. Rivera recorded that. They were planning another religion among the Ismailite descendants in Arabia. So this was planned 300 years earlier, but they were slowly moving, putting things together so that it will take place somewhere in the future. This plan was implemented and came to being around 600 and 700 AD, with Muhammad being trained by Catholic priests. If you read about Muhammad to the true writers' record, they record that Muhammad was trained by Catholic priests. Muhammad was taught that the only true Christians are the Catholic, and the rest are heretics. No wonder Islam teaches they hate Christianity, because Muhammad was taught that by the Catholic priests. And point number 12, the new religion became so powerful and out of control that from that time till today, they are still growing and very visible in their demands. We see them today on the news. Trump, the new president-elect, is saying ISIS will have to go down, because ISIS is agitating the whole world through their activities. This is from Islam. Let's look at a timeline. Right from Ishmael, we've talked about Ishmael, Esau, the Exodus in the 1500 BC, then Babylon when Daniel was writing, Daniel 11, 600 BC, then came the Greek Empire, just before the four horns, in 331 to 147 BC. Then Christ came in 27 AD, when he was baptized. After he died in 31 AD, the little horn appeared in 538 AD. 500 years later, after Christ, the little horn ruled whole of Western Europe and killed so many Christians. That was in 500 AD onwards. The birth of Islam came after that, around about 700 AD. That's when Islam started to spread its wings around that area, the Arabian Peninsula, until 1798, when the king, Napoleon sent his general up to Rome and brought the Pope down, and he died in captivity, 1798. That was the end of the papal rule, which ended the Dark Ages. But did it end there? Well, we'll find out later. Well, let's get back to the Bible. Daniel 11 verse 40 says this. Let's read 2-3. And at the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind. Let's stop there. What time are we talking about?
The end times.
End times. And where is the end time?
Now.
Now. We are talking about now. This is what Daniel wrote when he was in Babylon. When he was in Babylon, he wrote about what we are going to face today. We are going to face today. Daniel had already been foretold back then. And what was he told? That the king of the south, who's the king of the south?
The Ptolemy.
Ptolemy. And which religion is now in the king of the south's area?
Christian.
No.
Roman Catholic.
It's Islam. It's the king of the south. All those areas are Islamic. So the king of the south, it says here, shall push against the king of the north. King of the north? Who is the king of the north now? Let's just quickly go back here so that in this, remember, we are talking about this area, this time period here. The king of the north was Syria, the Seleucids. Who took over all this area? When Rome came into power, the fifth. When Rome came into power, the feet of the image, represented by the feet of the image, they took over all this northern part and went up right up into Europe. The king of the north, who's the king of the north now? It's the Pope of Rome. So in this prophecy in Daniel 11 verse 40, it's saying, the king of the south, Islam, is come up into the areas of the king of the north, the papal system.
Mm-hmm.
And what is he doing? He's pushing at him. What did the king of the north do? And the king of the north
shall come against him like a whirlwind.
He will react. Is he reacting today? Slowly he is beginning to make laws, reacting to the push of the king of the south. Remember, the king of the south have grown so powerful that he is out of his control anymore, even though he was the one who created this religion. Now he's not in control. Now this religion has come up into his area and pushing onto him. And what did the Bible say that he will do? He will come down on the king of the south like a whirlwind. Can you relate that to what is happening today? We have Islamic demands all over the place, even here in Americas. They demand this, they demand that, they're taking advantage of the human rights that people have come up with. And slowly people are giving all these rights to them. And they're demanding more. The Bible said that among his brethren, he will be agitating everyone. And that's exactly what's happening today. The king of the north will react and will come against him like a whirlwind. Who is going to do that? Does the Pope have any military to do this? No. It's just a small state. But the thing is to remember, all the people with the military go and bow down to this Pope. They are the ones who he will use to push on the king of the south. And see what happens. With chariots, with horsemen, with many ships, he will enter into the countries and shall overflow and pass over. He will come, just raid the whole place and pass over it. King of the North, that's what he'll do to the Islamic religion. Listen to verse 41.
He shall enter also into the glorious land.
Who's the glorious land? Who's the glorious land?
America.
King of the north, king of the south. Who's in between?
Jerusalem.
Jerusalem. the people of God, this is the glorious land. He will not only go down to the south and like a whirlwind, he will also enter into the glorious land. Remember
Alberto
Rivera? What did he say? The Roman Catholic Church in 200 AD, in the late 200 ADs, wanted to take Jerusalem and make it into a Roman Catholic city, holy city. The Bible says that the king of the north, on his trip down south now, will not only raid all the Islamic countries, he says it will get or enter into the countries, but will also enter into the
glorious land,
into Israel, into Jerusalem, because they wanted to make Jerusalem the Catholic holy city. That's what will happen. Here's points 1 to 4. Somehow it went right to the end. Well, anyway, we've already covered that. Verse 42 of the same chapter. It says, he shall stretch forth his hand, who? The king of the north. The papal system. And also upon the countries
and the land of Egypt shall not escape.
What do you know about the land of Egypt? The Ptolemies. They will not escape you. 43.
But he shall have power over the treasures of gold and of silver.
Money. And the finance of the world will be under the king of the north's power.
And over all the precious things of Egypt, and the Libyans, and the Ethiopians shall be at his steps.
All these will be at his, under his power. This is the main where we will end today's study. Verse 44, remember this. 2, 3, but it starts with the word but.
Tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him. Therefore, he shall go forth with great fury to destroy and utterly to make away many.
He started his raid from the north, cleaned out the Islamic religion. Then he came down south, entered into countries. Egypt itself will not escape this man, the king of the north. Not only that, he will go up and enter into the glorious land, Jerusalem, Israel. He will take Israel over and make it one of his holy cities. This is what the Bible has predicted. And what does this verse 44 say? Even with all that under his grips, he is troubled. Let's read again.
But the tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him.
Stop there. There's one message. A tiding is a message. And that message is troubling this very strong king. Because of that message, what will he do? He shall go forth with great fury. It makes him very angry by hearing this message. To destroy and utterly to make many away. To kill. Because of that message. He doesn't care about Islam anymore. He's raided them. He does not care about Israel anymore. He's entered into the glorious land and he's taken the city and made it one of its holy city. He is troubled by the message, by the tidings that is coming from the north and from the east. What message is it? Listen to this. Revelation 14. 6 to 8. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven. This is the message that is troubling the king of the north. Having the everlasting gospel. Which is the everlasting gospel? This one. This gospel started from the beginning of this world. It's still here today. And John saw it in the sanctuary up in heaven. That's where this message is. And it will continue till eternity. The everlasting gospel. This angel is coming out with that everlasting gospel and telling the people to worship God. Worship God, for he made this earth. What's the second angel's message? Another angel said, Babylon, Rome, king of the north, they've already fallen. Come to me because I am the victor, the real victor. Don't worry about the king of the north doing all this destruction all over the land. I am the victor. Babylon has already fallen. And the third angel says in verse 9, in smaller prints down below.
And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice,
if any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead, in his hands,
the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God,
in short,
which is poured out.
In short, if you fail, if you worship, or if you fall into the trap that the king of the north has set by drinking of his wine of fornication, his false teachings, remember, Revelation 14:1 wants to bring out the false teachings and assure you with the truth of the Bible. And this is the truth about the Bible. If you fail to hear this message, you will drink of the wine of the wrath of God. You will face God's anger. So that's the end message today. Even though we are looking back at history, the Bible has foretold everything. And everything is becoming very clear if you watch the news. You watch Trump. The Bible says in Revelation 13 that this second beast will force the whole world to bow down to the first beast. America will force the whole world to bow down to Rome, the papal system in Rome.
Roman Catholic Church.
Things are just falling into place. The jigsaw puzzle is completing very fast. I beg you, brothers and sisters, the Bible, this book, is so full of knowledge that when you study it, things just brighten up. Do not waste it laying on the shelf somewhere in your homes. Open it up and ask God prayerfully to give you the knowledge. And he'll be able to tell you what's happening on the TV. You watch on the TV every day about Islam, about Rome, about America, about the whole world. That's what this book will tell you and will enlighten you in the future. That is where we'll end, and I pray that you will be enlightened by the little message I've shared with you today. Let us pray.